Okay, I'm gonna count to three, and I'm gonna ask you when my eyes, when I'm actually turned around, to clap if you started working on problem. One, two, three. Okay, you guys need to get your act together. There's about 15 suggested problems for chapter two, which has to do with solving, most of them solving asset-based problems. You need to practice that. There's a couple of them that are particularly complex. We were talking about it in office hours. I'm gonna post kind of like a long-term resolution for those two problems. I think they're 18 and 19 in the new edition. But you need to start working, and you're also likely to get more problems to practice on in section. So please, please get started. In like 2 weeks, we'll have our first exam. We're not even that. So don't fall behind. Unless you already totally know asset-based, and then ignore me. But you have to start working on the ones from chapter three that will be posted today. So we're talking about ionization of amino acids. We had started with this idea of the concept of a sweeter ion, which was the particular form of an amino acid in which the net charge is zero. Then I told you that amino acids can act as buffers. There's two places where we have pKa. And this is kind of an average pKa. Every amino acid has a little bit of a different number for the pKa of the alpha carboxyl group and the amino group. You don't have to go and memorize that one is 2.34 and the other one is 2.19. These are the numbers that we expect you to know and assume that they're the same for all amino acids. So here we have two different places where the amino acid can act as a buffer. And I had asked you to look at this and to think about it. So one of the things that people that come up is the idea that if you look at a carboxyl group in the most kind of like vanilla environment possible where nothing is going on, you have the pKa for the carboxyl group is about 4.8. However, when you look at an amino acid, the pKa is a lot more negative. So this means that for this to become protonated, you really need to have a very acidic pH. So it's easier for this to become deprotonated. And the idea is that this amino group here, to the carbon, is actually attracting some of the electrons for the carboxyl group. And as a result of that, this proton is actually looser than it would be here. So when you look at this and you have the free electrons, those electrons are actually stabilized by being pulled by the positive charge of the amino group. As a result of that, it is easier, or you can shed this proton at lower pHs than you can do when it doesn't have that stabilization form. Does that make sense? If we look at the amino group, we have kind of like a similar effect where the oxygen atoms here can actually also withdraw some of the electrons of the amino group. And as a result of that, it becomes easier, or you can shed the proton at a lower pH. This is important because, not just because it's the kind of like the free amino acid, but because this is going to happen within the pockets of proteins where the environment around a particular carboxyl group, amino group, or side group can affect what the actual pKa value is. So in the case of histidine that has a pKa value of 6, yes, the pH in cells is normally 7. But you could make an environment where you can shift that pKa closer to 7. Is that something that if you're going to need a higher or lower pH to shed the protons? If you shift the pH, pKa to 7, you need a higher or lower pH to release the protons. It used to be pKa 6, now it's pKa 7. Do we need a higher pH or a lower pH to release the protons?
Higher.
So, if we look, this is just the simplest titration curve. It's glycine, you only have two groups that are ionizable. But you can actually have things that have multiple groups. So here, if you look at glutamate, we have the first pKa, which you can see is similar but not identical to the numbers I gave you before. Don't worry about it. You can function fine with these two numbers. So here we have the first pKa, here we have the second pKa, and then there's the pKa of the side chain, which in the case of an exam, we would give you unless it's listed in. So the question then becomes, at what pH will this amino acid be neutral? So what you would do is you would start looking at different examples. You would choose a pH 1, pH 3, pH 7, pH 11, and find what ionized, what forms you have. So at pH 1, somewhere around here, you're going to have that everything is protonated, so the charge is going to be 1. If we look in between the next two pKa's, you have that this guy is deprotonated, everything else is protonated, you have a charge of 0. You continue with the protonate, the next carboxyl group, minus charge of minus 1. We lose the amino group, the extra proton, you end up with a charge of minus 2. Are we clear on how to do this from yesterday? How you can calculate? Now that you want to choose pH values that are at least 1 point away from the pKa. So it turns out that this particular amino acid has a charge of 0 somewhere in between this pKa and this pKa. The pH at which an amino acid has a charge of 0 is called the isoelectric point. And in order to find out what that pH is, the way you calculate that is you take whatever your compound is, in this case it's just an amino acid, but you take your compound, you calculate the charge in between each of the pKa's, and you're going to do this in a moment, not just theoretically here. You find the two pKa's around that whatever pH you came up with, that this is 0. And then you take these two pKa's and you add them up and you divide them by 2. And that will give you the isolated point. So, we let amino acid be more soluble in water or less soluble in water if the pH is equal to its isoelectric point. Take a moment to think about it. Would amino acid be more soluble in water or less soluble in water if the pH of the solution is equal to its isoelectric point? You have a 50-50 chance, so talk to each other for a moment. Will an amino acid be more soluble or less soluble if the pH of a solution is equal to its isoelectric point?
Less point.
Yeah.
More soluble?
It'll be less soluble.
So you should say either more or less. I'm going to count to 3. 1, 2, 3.
Less.
Yes, it is less soluble. Awesome. That is usually something people get stuck on. Why is it less soluble?
Since
it's in most non-polar state it has. If you are in anything but the isoelectric point, you actually have charges which will make it more likely that you can interact with water and you'll be more soluble. So how do you estimate the isoelectric point when the side chain is ionizable? You identify the species that carries a net zero, and you find the two pKa values around that, and you take the average of those two pKa values. So here's another example. Again, you calculate the pKa, you get the pKa's, you find the value which are zero, and you take those two pKa points. Okay, I've been hammering you about histidine having the pKa similar to pH 6. So, we rarely worry about amino acids in solution. We normally have peptides. When you look at a peptide, you have the amino group is free at one end, the carboxyl group is free at the other end. All of the other amino carboxyl groups are irrelevant because they're now joined in an amide bond. So realistically, you only worry about one amino group, one carboxyl group, and whatever residue, whatever ionizable events you have on the side chain. Okay, so the alpha and the amino carboxyl groups involved in the peptide bond can ionize. These two can ionize. Their pKa's are going to be a little bit different from the free amino acid because in the case of this amino group, you don't have two oxygens pulling from here as you did before. And in the case of this carboxyl group, you don't have the three electrons from the amino group pulling from here. But for the purposes of what we're going to do, you can use the same numbers unless we tell you that there's something different. Sorry, everything I'm saying is written down, and I find it boring to read my own slides. This is all the things that everybody said. So let's take this peptide here. I'm giving you the pKa's of the carboxyl and amino group. You can see that they're different because they're not in the same environment. This is the other two pKa. Would you please let me know what the isoelectric point is for this peptide? You would use the same logic that you did before. You would go through the different pHs, you would find out at which pH is zero, and then you would calculate the isoelectric point. You have 3 minutes to do that.
We have a molecules at zero. All right, I'm sure she.
Sorry, I had to go and figure out because I did the math myself, but I had good enough. Okay, I'm going to count to three. What is the isoelectric point of this peptide? 1, 2, 3.
6.2.
You guys are so awesome! That is totally fine. You see, it's not that hard. The only difference, if we weren't going to like an exams context, is that I would probably not have an arrow pointing to the specific group, but you'd be able to recognize amino acid. For each amino acid, you should know what are the ionizable groups. So when you learn the structure, just double check on that. So now you don't have to read all of this, but I wrote the whole thing. And you just get to the answer with the 6.2. Are we okay with a selected point? For amino acids, for peptides? Why should we care? Proteins are less soluble in the isoelectric point. So most proteins don't have an isoelectric point at this pH that you find in your body. It would be a very bad idea if they did. But we're going to see on Tuesday how we can use in experiments the isoelectric point to help us work with proteins. And it can also be used to study, to figure out if a protein has been modified somehow. So if you have a peptide and you know the isoelectric point, but it's not behaving as if that were its isoelectric point, then you know that something's been changed. And one of the changes that will affect it is if the protein has been phosphorylated. And phosphorylation is a huge thing in protein regulation. And we'll talk more about that. So we'll use the isoelectric point on Tuesday. Before we continue, we're going to do clicker questions.
We all have to silent?
Huh?
Did they make you stay silent for 10
minutes? Those are not calculators. They're cell phones. You need one of those Asian devices that do not have GPS or data access. Next!
Oh.
You have a minute and a half.
And bring it that
way.
I can't.
Do an area that they shake your mom. I mean, technically,
it's not C. It's not A.
Yeah,
it's between B and C.
But when a D be technically correct,
it's like if you're at the center, then it's half.
Yeah.
If you're at the far left, then it's full.
Yeah, but if you're at the far, but if you have one pH above the PPA,
then it's just going to be most.
Oh, is that what you're saying? Oh, I thought it was
the
same thing.
Yeah, at the pH.
Okay.
Yeah, that's when you don't want to use it as a buffer.
Oh, you're right, yeah. That was
so
okay,
yeah, I think B is the same thing. There's no way it's not going to be.
Actually, I think the definition of PPA is that the equal amount of edge and the contribution base. I think the definition of KA is
the
equal amount of
equal
player.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
We agreed on B because D is not, B is safer than B.
Yes, it is B.
Yeah.
You're far right. Put in this protonated and this is example, if you don't remember. It doesn't matter what the compound is. It will be fully protonated to the right. You don't actually need to know anything about it. That's what the curve tells you.
I don't think the pH is going to be a constant, though.
That's totally
true.
I agree.
There's a formal question about this one, like probably the pH ability. I mean, the buffering ability.
Oh, where did you find the
buffering? On the 6th edition. The range of the buffer is like plus or minus 1.
No, yeah, I agree. I was gonna say. Plus A's, I feel like more absolute and absolute ones.
Yeah.
Are we agreed on
that?
Because A seems it's not gonna be like a strict pH, but as long as you like keep it, like if you look at the titration curve, like that one.
Yeah, exactly.
I'm gonna ask you to talk to each other. We're gonna do this again in about a minute.
I'm sorry. What model
is
it?
Which is Sunny.
A Sunny, okay.
Are you Chinese?
Yeah.
Underdog boys.
So the question is asking you. This was before.
Oh.
We were doing better before.
I love you. Damn.
This is the right answer.
I like you.
So stand your ground.
Damn.
They're both going to Cam, but let's take a look at this for a moment. I was like, no, so the question is, what is the function? Why do we use a buffer? We use a buffer because we would like to maintain a constant pH even if there's changes in acid or alkali. The fact is, buffers are only useful within one pH unit of the pKa, but that's a disadvantage of the buffer. Ideally, we would like the buffers to be totally effective. This is a restriction or limit. It is not the function. The function is to keep the pH constant. The fact is, that only works if you are at a pH around a unit of the pKa. Does that make sense, the distinction? It is a semantic distinction, but be careful with the wording. And don't worry, we're going to have a lot of quicker questions. My goal is that you should all get full credit for all of that. Last one for today. And it's also a lesson on, like, stand your ground if you think you're right.
It should be hydrophobic. No. Because it's all
hydrophobic.
It's all methyls. Is it?
All methyls. All methyls.
Yeah, so it's non-polar.
What is
it's not hydrophobic? Hydrophobic.
Looking at the structure. We're
looking at the structure. 5, 4, 3. We're missing a couple of people. Maybe they died. Okay. Everybody okay? Check out your neighbors. Okay, we lost two people. I'm sorry. You guys are so cool, look at that! Woo! And in case you don't remember, we have a very hydrophobic side chain. Okay, take a 5-minute break, go and get water, we're having a heat wave. Don't get dehydrated.
It's been 15 minutes already?
The only thing I'm going to say is quaternary only happens if you have more than one polypeptide chain. If a protein is made of a single polypeptide chain, we will call that polypeptide chain by itself a protein. If a protein is made of many polypeptide chains, then we call the polypeptide chain a subunit. So this would be a subunit, but it is a full polypeptide chain in the same way as this would be. Was that clear or totally confusing? Confusing? Okay, let's do it again. What I'm trying to say is, If a protein is made of a single polypeptide chain, you would try to use those two terms interchangeably. You would say polypeptide chain or protein, and that's the same thing. However, if in order to be functional, it needs to have several polypeptide chains, we call those polypeptide chains subunits. And we call all of the subunits together a protein. So what we call a protein is somewhat subjective, depending on what is the final active form of all of that thing put together. Does that make more sense? So the thing that matters the most for proteins is their actual spatial conformation. And to this day, that remains a problem. How we go from here to here remains a problem that is not trivial to solve. Couple of things. The three-dimensional conformation is what is key for its biological function, because that's how it's able to interact with its ligand, substrate, or partner proteins. Usually when you're looking at a protein, you will, for example, look at something like this. Any idea what this is? Hemoglobin. And you will try to look at what are the areas that are interactive, that are free to interact, what are the pockets that are exposed to the water environment. I'm never going to test you on something like this. I'm just asking whether you knew it or not. The structure that a protein acquires spontaneously is called the native fold of that protein. Most proteins only have one functional native fold. There's exceptions, but the large majority of them only have one functional native form. This is usually the form that has the lowest possible energy. Therefore, it's the most stable form. So we're going to discuss a little bit about how we actually go from a polypeptide that is free floating around to an actual three-dimensional structure. And the fact that this has a very high cost in the context of entropy. When you have a protein that is just floating around without any form of structure, it can acquire a pseudo-infinite number of possible conformations. You have a little string that is floating around and you can do whatever you want with it. The moment it actually falls, it stabilizes into one conformation that will vibrate and will have a little bit of segments that might be freer. But overall, you've actually dramatically reduced the entropy of that system. This is one of the first proteins that was studied. This is pancreatic RNase A. You do not need to memorize the structure. But it was the protein that was used for the antisense experiments. Have you guys heard about that in Bio-1A? No? So this is a classic experiment in protein chemistry. The idea is you start with what is a fairly small protein, and he denatured it with urea and beta-mercaptopril ethanol. So urea is going to disrupt the ionic interactions, is changing the salt environment in the solution. Beta-mercaptopril ethanol is a reducing agent that is used a lot. So it's going to reduce and therefore separate or break all of the disulfide bonds. So you have now a completely unfolded protein. Again, still a very short, only 124 amino acids. What he did, so Alvinson is a person. What he did is he took the protein that was in solution with salt and beta-mercaptopril ethanol and removed those two things by dilution. So basically he really diluted the solution. We would reduce the concentration of urea and beta-mercaptopril ethanol very quickly. And what happened is the protein did some weird thing, ended up folding incorrectly and precipitating. But if he actually did a very slow dialysis, so he slowly extracted the urea and the beta-mercaptopril ethanol, the protein folded back to its original structure and was completely active. This has had very strong implications because this protein was made inside of a cell. In a cell, there's other proteins, there's specific solutions, there's vitamins that act as cofactors, there's ions. So this folded inside of the cell. But then this second fold was done in a tube with a very controlled solution, which it was literally just water, and pretty much just water, and it folded correctly. So this provided evidence that the actual folding of a protein is determined by its primary structure. This was the first experiment to really show that. You don't need additional proteins, you don't need additional health ions, anything. All of the information you need to acquire the correct tertiary structure is in the sequence of that protein. This was done in 1973, and to this day we cannot actually predict correctly from a primary structure what the tertiary structure is going to be. There's a caveat to this experiment. This was a very short protein. Inside of cells, proteins that are much larger usually need help to fold correctly. And that help is provided by other proteins that are called chaperonins. You have heard of that, of those? So we'll be talking about that. So what are the energetic events that are taking place when you go from here to here? Again, this can have any possible conformation, but much more limited in the folded state. So this is kind of trying to summarize, we're going to be seeing this over time. Oops. So if you look at the unfolded state, you're forming hydrogen bonds with water, more than with yourself. When you're in the folded state, you brought the amino acids closer to each other so they can actually form hydrogen bonds with each other. But overall, the total number of hydrogen bonds is not changing because the group that could form hydrogen bonds with water is now forming it with the actual peptide. So the enthalpy itself doesn't change much, but you actually have released a lot of water molecules to do whatever they want. So this change has an increasing entropy in the context of the water. Does that make sense? Yes? No?
Yep.
Yep. Okay. The second thing is, when you're in water, your salt bridges is the same thing as ionic bonds. I guess that's not clear. When you're in water, all of the ionic bonds are kind of being, there's interference run by water. So water has a higher dielectric constant, which means that water can actually interact with the ions. So what you're comparing is, if you have two ions in vacuum, they will attract each other a lot. That would be like a dielectric constant of zero. When you put them in water, now each ion is surrounded by a water shell, so some of the charge is already being kind of reduced by the fact that you're interacting with water. So sodium and chloride in water attract each other less. Does that make sense? Because there already some of the charge is being shielded by the water. Yes? No? Okay. I'm hearing one yes and nobody else at at the back? Okay. If you're in the folded state, you exclude water. So you actually can form stronger bonds. If you remember, stronger bonds have lower energy. So the overall enthalpy is going to have increased, which is favorable to you. In the unfolded state, you are exposing more hydrophobic residues to water, so they're forcing water shells around them. In the folded state, you have less hydrophobic groups exposed to water. They usually expose hydrophobic packing. The hydrophobic sites into amino acids tend to be found in the inside of proteins. This again holds three more water and is entropically favored. This is not all that is going on, but it's kind of a first pass on the idea of that the energetic changes that are happening when you're folding a protein. It doesn't tell you how it's going to fold or what the final state is going to be, but it tells you what might be the reason why there's some you favor folding over remaining unfolded. In both cases, you have analogs. So there are some constraints, though, as to how proteins can fold. They're not completely free. One of those constraints comes from the peptide bond itself. So the peptide bond can actually, this is what we normally depict as a stable form, but it's actually shifting back and forth between having the double bond with the oxygen or having a double bond between the carbon and the nitrogen. So when you have this phenomenon that you're going back and forth, we say that you have two tautomers and you have a process, and I'm probably killing this in pronunciation and I apologize, tautomerization. Which means that the actual stayed here, the electrons are not locked into the carbon and oxygen, are actually delocalized and floating back and forth. You're not always like this, but some of the time you are. So we say that the dipeptide bond, which is the carbon and the nitrogen, has a double bond nature, or a partial double bond nature. And if you remember from OCHEM, things cannot rotate around double bonds. As a result of that, this is forcing this part of the protein to be locked into a planar position. You cannot rotate, so the idea is that these guys cannot rotate with respect to each other anymore. They're kind of locked in a position, which will define a plane in the structure of the protein. So this is trying to show that plane and kind of telling you that you end up with the pi orbitals that are actually perpendicular to that plane. The other thing that this is going to do, which we'll talk more in a moment, is that it creates almost like a dipole, a very weak and local dipole, where this will be partially negative and this will be partially positive. And that has implications as to how the protein would arrange itself. The other thing, the other constraint when we're trying to understand how protein falls, is that when you're looking at the organization of, the placement of the side chains, normally you find that the side chains are alternating in position. They're not on the same side, but on sequential amino acids, they're on opposite sides. The reason for that is to avoid the steric clashing, so the physical hitting of the two side chains with each other. If you have them alternated, there's a lot more space. So this could be, I don't know, tryptophan, which has a huge side chain. And this could be histidine, which is pretty large. So in this disposition, they interact less, and they're freer to move around. This would actually cause problems. It would not be a stable compound. There's one exception to this, which is if you look at proline, where you put proline here, because of its structure, there's not a lot of steric clash, regardless of the position of the other amino acid. So when you look at bonds that have proline, you can actually find them in cis or trans. So they're still more common in the trans form. So we're looking at kind of what are the boundaries that we have towards linking our protein folding. So the peptide bond means that that section of the peptide has to be planar. Then we have this steric clashing problem. So if you have to kind of try to figure out how the polypeptide chain looks like, it's like a sequence of planes for each amide bond with the side chains in alternating positions. Questions? I know I'm just kind of like telling you things the way they are. The last thing is, so this is the things that are stable. You cannot rotate along the carbon and nitrogen bond, but you can rotate along the carbon and the alpha carbon bond. So if we go back here, so you can imagine that you can have a stick and you can rotate the whole plane. And you can also rotate between the nitrogen and the alpha carbon. So you have rotation here and rotation here. That would be, and it's always, I've actually tried to do this with little sticks and blue one, it has been not interesting. But that means that you have two planes, and the planes themselves can rotate with respect to each other. And you're looking at the angle of this plane from your alpha carbon, and you're looking at the angle of this plane from your alpha carbon. Does that make sense? Yes, no, more or less, maybe. So, Alison, can you come over? I need an alpha carbon. And you put like your hand as a fist in the middle. Oh, what am I gonna do? Okay. So her hand is the alpha carbon. Are we okay? We have two planes with respect to this, which are then themselves can rotate with respect to the position of the alpha carbon. And this rotation is independent. So they could be found. This gives you a lot of flexibility in when you're forming the shape of your protein, because you could rotate this in any way you want. Does that help? The angle at which you're rotating has two names depending on whether which of these two planes you're looking at. Okay, so Alison, you were a great alpha carbon. We have to have fun because this is a long class. We will celebrate our small lunch. Okay, so these are the planes that we're talking about. This is Alison's hand, and this is us rotating the planes around them. If we're looking at how much we have rotated the plane, so you have like a, if you were totally planar and then you're rotating it, in the clockwise direction, this rotation here is measured by an angle that is called phi. So how much you're rotating with respect to the alpha to the plane positions is called phi. And phi is between the alpha carbon and the nitrogen. And then between the alpha carbon and the other carbon, the rotation of that plane is called psi. And this is a website where you can actually play around with the angles to get a little bit more intuitive idea. So if I have this amino acid interacting with an amino acid to the left and an amino acid to the right, I can describe to you the exact position with respect to each other if I tell you what this rotation angle is and what the rotation angle is. You will know exactly how this they are connected to each other. And what this angle will be depends on if you're just looking at a single polypeptide or short peptide, depends on what the amino acids are. So depending on what the R group is, it's going to push or not the other amino acid to rotate a little bit more or less. So you can go and model, taking into account the different orbitals, you can model if this amino acid is glycine and this amino acid is, I don't know, proline, what are the possible angles I could find? Now, this amino acid is glycine and this amino acid is tyrosine, what are the possible angles I can find? And when you do that, you come up with a whole description of the possible angles that you can find in across amino acids, which you will not have to do, but somebody did. And then you can also, for example, look at, okay, so if you have those particular flexions of the planes, which of those would break an alpha helix and which of those would be actually favorable to an alpha helix? In the alpha helix, you're trying to create a rotation like this. If you have a plane that will shift out, that would be unfavorable. If you have a plane that kind of goes with the rotation, that would be a favorable interaction. So there's combinations of phi and psi angles that are actually favor certain, that are more likely to happen, to put it that way, than this. So for example, this would be a particular flexion where there's a lot of steric flash, so that would not happen. This is something where the amino acids are very comfortable with respect to each other, so this is something that would be very favorable. Does that make sense? And the point is that you will not have to calculate that. But you can actually, there's programs that will do this for you. And it turns out that this is something that's favored, this is something that's favored. But apart from being energetically possible, they also tend to push proteins into one form of folding or the other. So if you find this kind of combination of psi and phi, it tends to be in beta sheets. So these kind of changes in the plane will favor beta sheets. These kind of stronger rotations, so this will favor something that's more planar. this, which is actually forming deeper angles, favors something that has to turn. So that favors the alpha helices that we see as secondary structures. So pulling back for a moment, we're talking about what are the things that are all about protein folding that are already set and we can kind of understand and predict from looking at the primary structure. We can understand the planar nature of the double bond. We can understand the angles that specific amino acids can form to each other. And we also know that they tend to be, in order to look at those angles, you know that they tend to also be on kind of like a transform. All of that kind of gives you a framework where you're trying to think about how proteins will fold. It doesn't tell you what the final folding is. If anything, it helps you know what kind of foldings are impossible. It helps you exclude things that just can't happen. And it leaves you with kind of like a subset of possible shapes and structures that a protein could have. Are we okay? Should I say that again? Up, middle, down, up, okay. Thank you. Sorry for asking so much, but I really want to make sure that we're all on the same page. So those are the constraints that we understand. So then when you look at proteins, those constraints will kind of tell you whether an amino acid sequence will form alpha helices, whether they would form beta strands, or whether they're going to be completely unfolded and form loops. And you can pretty much predict this from a small peptide by looking at the amino acids and the sequence. You can predict if it's going to be an alpha helix, a beta strand, or kind of like a loose loop. And you cannot force them in the other way. There's no condition you can put, there's no salt condition, etc., where you can force it into the other shape. If we look at the structure of, so everybody's familiar with the rebound diagrams. This is usually how we show beta strands with arrows, and the alpha helices are shown as like little rings. Alpha helices are going, the way that they're structured, they're stabilized by hydrogen bonds between nearby residues. So the word residue here is referring to the amino acids, but remember we call them residues because they're not floating around by themselves, they're now part of a polypeptide. And the beta sheet is going to be across a segment and not with a nearby amino residue. I'll show all of that so I'm not just talking in air. The alpha helix will have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 amino acids. There's a couple of things about it that you need to know. It has to do with the structure of an alpha helix. There's 3.6 residues per turn. And the distance between two amino acids is 1.5 angstroms. The whole turn is going to be 5 or 4 angstroms per second. In the context of an example, it would be if I said, please describe the overall structure of an alpha helix. I'm not going to write a question in an exam as multiple choice and say, the distance between is 5.4 angstroms or 5.3. Does that make no sense? The peptide bonds are running in parallel with the axis, so it's kind of like the amino acids are up. And the side chains are towards the outside, and they're perpendicular to this axis. Two amino acids you do not tend to find in alpha helices are proline and glycine. Proline will tend to break them, and glycine is just too flexible, so it doesn't make for a stable alpha helix. And I do want to show you that this is how alpha helices actually look like. There's no space inside of them. We always show them to you like this or like that, and you're like, oh my god, you could like put your finger there. And it is not. They're actually completely packed. This is showing some of the features that we talked about. So here you see, there you were seeing the hydrogen bonds. You see them that are going on between the two different residues. I was so focused on explaining the plot, I didn't actually highlight the name. These are called Ramachandran plots. I really don't care how they're called as long as you understand what they're showing you, but we should honor the fact that they're called Ramachandran plots. You okay with that? I'm actually glad that the computer went down because I should have stopped and have you talk to each other for a little while. It wakes you up and it helps us figure out what the doubts you have. Any doubts come up that you want to ask about? Any questions that came up when you were talking with other people? Yes, out there. So the 5.4 angstrom is, when it says, you know, 3.6 residues, that would be 5.4 angstrom. So you're like, show me this carbon and here's this carbon. Physics! Yeah. Alpha helices are normally right-handed. And there's a question back there, and then there's a question there. So there. Eight amino acids. I don't remember what I meant. Anybody remembers in what context I said that?
It was the slide with like another slide back. Yeah, this slide right here.
Oh my god, no, there's 3.6 amino acids per term. I apologize if you fixed it. No idea what that means. Please do call me out on things that I said that are wrong. We all learn and we all make mistakes. The GSI satisfaction is stopping me when I say something wrong.
Why does tautomerization matter for protein structures?
So, if you didn't have tautomerization, let's go back for a sec. Just show. So, imagine that this was a different atom that could not actually have the electrons floating. You would have this carbon with a double bond here, and then this bond would be able to rotate. So when I show you and I say that, you know, this looks like this, so you have these planes and these are the angles that you have to worry about, you would actually have no planes and this would also be able to rotate. So the number of possible conformations that the protein would have would escalate dramatically. It's not that it's important in the context that does it help the proteins in itself, it creates a stable plane that helps the protein have a particular structure. But if they would rotate, it would just increase the number of possible shapes that the protein could have. Does that help? So it's not like it helps the protein, it's just a constraint. The fact that you have a double bond, a partial double bond, so the possibility of having a double bond here is fixing the relationship between that carbon and that nitrogen. The same way, you know, this relationship here is fixed, but nobody cares because the oxygen doesn't connect to anything else. But because this will connect across the chain, it just kind of fixes the relative position of the amino acids with each other. If you didn't have that, then you could actually also rotate here. It just would increase the number of possibilities. And possibly, you wouldn't end up having alpha helices or beta sheets as structure. You would have something else. This makes those particular secondary structures more stable.
It's the only thing that we have to go by inside, if they're clockwise or counterclockwise.
So what you need to know is, so when you're looking at them, which kind of angles can actually favor or not alpha helices or beta sheets? So you need to be able to look at a Ramachandran plot and identify the areas that would give alpha or beta. We're not going to ask you about a particular angle in that context, and you need to know which one is for like the nitrogen or the carbon. Does that answer your questions? Any other questions? Yes.
We need to know how to read the plot. But
you need to know how to read the plot, yes. With the caveat that unless I actually gave you like an actual shape, I'm not going to quote something here and here and go like, okay, know that this is 65 and that one was 68, and tell me the difference. I'm not going to go there. So overall, you have an idea what the plot is telling you. So right-handed alpha helices. It's amazing how much people don't understand this. Is DNA right-handed or left-handed?
No, it's right-handed.
Is basic DNA right-handed or left-handed?
Right-handed.
Okay, we're gonna come back to that. Think about it for next time. If I tell you, if I leave you with a question hanging, you'll actually look it up and remember it better. That's the logic, I'm not trying to torture you. Okay, so alpha helices are right-handed. The other aspect of alpha helices is here, is that, remember I mentioned that there was a local dipole in the peptide bond? Are people just Googling whether DNA is and ignoring me? Okay, so within each peptide bond, you end up having this kind of local dipole. And as a result of that, in the middle, they're kind of going to cancel each other. But when you look at the actual ends of an alpha helix, you're going to have an end that has a more positive side, sign or a positive charge, and the carboxy terminus end that's going to have a little bit of a more negative end. This actually will influence what amino acids you find at the end, or it doesn't influence. This actually is related to what amino acids you will find at the end of an alpha helix. So you will find amino acids that have negative charges usually closer to this area, to the amino terminal, than to the carboxy terminal. That's about all we care about the dipole. Once you have the alpha helix, that's great. That's one of the two possible secondary structures. But there's also what we call super secondary structures. So that means something that uses the alpha helix but acquires an additional structure that we tend to find in many places. So for example, keratin is an alpha helix protein that normally is not just found like this. What you normally find keratin is it will wrap itself in another keratin. After wrapping itself, they will get together head to tails with other keratins, forming a protofilament. And then they will continue to attach with each other, forming what's called a protofibril, which is basically just something that is really, really stable. This is the coil that you see here. This would be considered a super secondary structure because it's something that you find a lot and it's kind of a building unit for other things that come later. So the coil goes in keratin where the alpha helices are wrapped around each other. And then the other example of this is a super helix in collagen. Collagen has three alpha helices come together. And that makes a structure that makes it very stable. So this is just showing the protofilm, the protofilament, and the alpha helix. This is a cross-section of a hair. The idea is what you already, if you have, you know, one single strand, it's very easy to break. If you pack them all together, it makes something that's really, really strong. So your hair is proteins. And if you ever go and get your hair straightened or curved, so if you get a perm or not, what you're actually doing is you're trying to denature the connections that you have between the different coils of keratin. So they're all stable and they're all forming disulfide bonds. So when you try to curl your hair, those of us who try to curl their hair, you're literally trying to force this into a structure that is not very stable or favorable. So in order to force that, what you can do is you can break the disulfide bonds between the neighboring coils, bend your hair, and then reform those disulfide bonds. Have you ever had anything that is supposed to change the structure of your hair? It smells horrible. It has almost like a sulfur smell. So if you can actually change this, you first will reduce it, you give it a new shape, and you oxidize, you actually get your hair into a different shape. Beta sheets. So beta sheets, they happen because of this planar structure of the planes that can bond with each other. And then is that the tetrahedral geometry of the alpha carbon, carbons can actually form bonds with four planes, which gives them a tetrahedral structure. So what you see is that a beta strand by itself doesn't have hydrogen bond interactions between the amino acids in it. So the alpha helix is formed by having hydrogen bonds formed across amino acids. In the beta strand, the hydrogen bonds are formed across beta strands, not within the beta strand. The side chains in the alpha helix are towards the outside. There's no space for them to be in the inside of the alpha helix. In the beta sheets, the side chains will protrude also out, and they will be alternating in the different planes. You can have beta strands that come together in parallel or antiparallel form. So if you have antiparallel beta sheets, it just means that you're going in one direction or the other and then coming back. The direction is given by the N terminal to the C terminal. In antiparallel sheets, you actually have the ability to form hydrogen bonds that are parallel with each other, that are basically in a straight line. When you look at a parallel beta sheet, you're actually forcing the hydrogen bonds to be at an angle. So that makes those bonds weaker. So in parallel beta sheets, you're going to end up with weaker hydrogen bonds than in the antiparallel ones. That's what all of this is. The way that we normally depict the beta strands is by using arrows. And these arrows can rotate. You can depict it like this, so you can depict the tertiary structure where they're like all organized in space. In beta strands, you also need to be able to change position. So you have what's called beta turns, in order to go from one end to the other, to the other, to the other. The change in position can be accomplished with just four amino acids when you're turning around, and that's shown here. And you can have different kinds of beta turns. There's can be different ways in which the strands can come with each other. This can come and form different kinds of modules. So we saw super secondary structures with the alpha helices. You can also get super secondary structures with beta strands. And these are modules of beta strands that you tend to find in different proteins, always together. So this is a shape that you will find in immunoglobulins, would be like your antibodies. And you will find this particular shape repeated over and over. Or you can have a growth factor module, which just means you find this particular organization of the beta strands in different places, repeated over and over. So you can find it in different proteins, and you always find this particular shape. This is just a very small part of the protein. There will be other structures coming with. You do not have to memorize the structures. You just need to know that there are super secondary structures for beta sheets in the same way that you have them for alpha helices. And there's some that combine both. So this is one of the most common super secondary structures. It develops beta, alpha, beta. So the turn is made by using an alpha helix. You can have things that look like this, which is the alpha, alpha. You can have things that look like going up and down happily, which is called the beta meander. And then you can have also this other domain that looks weird, that it's called the Greek key, because it is similar to a depiction you can find in some Greek places. All of this, the reason we give them names is because you will find that thing across many proteins. So when you're describing the structure, you could describe the structure by saying, oh, well, there's a beta strand that's going up and then down and then up and then down. Or you could say, oh, it has a beta meander domain, and everybody knows what you're talking about. And this is an example of alternating beta and alpha strands. So going back to this structure, going up and down. We're going to talk about Pyro's full speed isomerase for the second part of the class. This is just to show how it can actually form a structure. You have a central barrel that is named by the beta strands, and it is surrounded by the alpha helices. Okay, so you do need to know that the alpha beta, that the beta alpha beta one is actually very common, and so that the alpha alpha beta number. These ones you should know, but at least you should be able to recognize this for the top three. So there's different when you're trying to study a protein. And the only thing you know is its primary sequence. We're going to see that things that you have a protein that you don't know anything about, there's ways that you can sequence in it. And we're going to talk about that on Tuesday. But if you know the sequence, then you can use the sequence and put it now into software that, looking at the amino acids, will predict if you have an alpha helix, a beta strand, or not in those sequences. But it will not be able to tell you how they organize with each other in space. But if you don't know the sequence and you would like to know if your protein has a lot of alpha helices or beta sheets, there's a different technique that you can use, where you will break your protein into peptides or small sequences, and you use circularly polarized light, which is what is showing here. So it's polarized light that is changing the angle as you're shining it. And you're going to look at the absorbance, and alpha helices, beta conformations, and random coils have different absorbance patterns. So if you break your protein into smaller segments, the segments by themselves should still be able to form the alpha helices or beta sheets. And you can actually see if there's alpha helices present or the other aspects. This is called circular decorrhizome. And it's used a lot in a lot of the labs on campus. Secondary structure. In general, the thought nowadays is that proteins start as a polypeptide floating around. They start forming secondary structures. And then those secondary structures will somehow come to form tertiary and quaternary structures. Secondary structures are based on the covalent bonds between amino acids. And then the only other thing that stabilizes them is hydrogen bonds. When we go into tertiary and quaternary structures, we actually start seeing a variety of bonds that come into play. And it becomes a lot harder to predict how this is going to look in space. So something like this can have ionic bonds, which are also what we call salt bridges, hydrogen bonds, like sulfide bonds, van der Waals, hydrophobic interactions. So all of this will come into play to form the final structure of a protein. The first protein whose tertiary structure was ever determined was myoglobin. Have you heard the story of how they did this? The first X-ray diffraction, that it took about 20 years more or less to actually compute the structure from the diffraction maps. Nowadays you put it in a computer and you have it within a day. They got the Nobel Prize for it. Science is fun, but it takes time. So we're not going to discuss how X-ray diffraction works. But the only thing I'm going to say is that it is one of the methods that people use in order to study the structure of proteins. You can have a variety of quaternary structures, tertiary and quaternary structures, which are a combination, sometimes only alpha helices, sometimes only beta strands, or all of them coming together. This is a cool quaternary structure. I'm biased, it's a chaperonin. My husband worked on it for 6 years. He hates it at this point, but it's pretty cool. So chaperonins help proteins fall. That's kind of, sorry. And the way that this is, GRO-YES and GRO-YEL, they actually form a barrel. So when a protein starts to fall, it actually goes into this barrel, which is made of 14 subunits. And that provides an environment that facilitates the folding of the protein. Once the protein is folded correctly, the barrel will open and the protein can escape. So it is just a super, super cool structure. And the thing that is, so we pull back for a moment. You have to form this quaternary structure. That means you make polypeptides, you read the DNA, you make the mRNA, you make the polypeptide that goes into the cytosol of your cell. Each of these polypeptides is floating around by itself. And by diffusion, they're going to move around and they're eventually going to find each other. And they have to have strong enough interactions to stay bound together. The fact that they actually find each other, to me, is already fascinating that those things can happen inside of the cells. So, how do we fold? We talked about some of the constraints. We talked about how they come together. But we still don't know how this happens. So this is kind of, someone tried to model how long it would take to fold a protein if you were doing it by trial and error, just moving around and combining amino acids. Bacteria can take a 100 amino acid protein and fold it correctly in 5 seconds. Each amino acid can find itself rotating in different ways and interacting in different ways. So you could end up with something like 10 to the 100 conformations for that protein. If you were sampling randomly each of those conformations till you actually fell into the one that's stable, it would take 10 to the 77 years to sample them all. So it is not possible that protein folding is just done by having a polypeptide floating around, kind of bouncing around, trying different things, and oh my god, by chance I found the correct one. That doesn't work. It has to be something that is more organized and structured. So at least nowadays, the thought is that you form the secondary structure first. This will limit the number of possible conformations you can have. But it's still not clear how you get to the final structure, and it's definitely not by just random chance. At least that's not what people think. Proteins can be native, can be misfolded, partially unfolded, or can be completely denatured. Proteins that are denatured, 5 more minutes! You guys can totally do this if I don't talk to the floor. Actually, we're gonna stop here. You could at least pretend that you were interested.